before we go there, I would like to recommend that everybody bring a Bible each week. And if you have a paper Bible rather than a phone Bible, bring that. If you do not have the books of the Bible memorized, where you can click it off and go quickly to that section, I would like you to turn to the table of contents in your Bible and become familiar with it. That, I think, is one of the places that we ignore in our Bibles. And if you don't know the books in order, oftentimes when someone is teaching and they refer to another book, and you're trying to get there, by the time you get there, they're done reading it, making their comment, and they've moved on. So if you are one that hasn't memorized those, you might want to put a tab or a piece of a post-it note or something to that effect, where you can move to the table of contents quickly, because we do, I call it taking a field trip. We take a field trip to another passage, and we'll read the passage, and we may have a comment or two from that, and then we'll return to the text. So tonight, again, 1 Samuel, and before we get into the book itself, we want to cover a few things concerning the Old Testament, the Bible in general, and 1 Samuel specifically. So initially, when the Bible was written, there was not a book of 1 Samuel and a book of 2 Samuel. In the original Hebrew scriptures, there was the book of Samuel. And it wasn't until the middle of the 3rd century BC when there was a group of men in Alexandria, Egypt, who were commissioned to translate the Bible into the common language of the day. And that at that time was Greek. So it would be as if today we didn't have the Bible in English. What good would that be to us? Excuse me. We could have somebody read it for us and then explain it to us, but without having a Bible that we were able to read, our understanding of the requirements of the scripture and the character of God would be drastically reduced. So this official, his name escapes me at the moment, he commissioned, I believe, 70 or 72 scholars to translate the Bible from Hebrew, the primary language of the Old Testament, into Greek. And can somebody tell me the name of that translation?
Septuagint.
Exactly. It's called the Septuagint. And the name is a play on the 70 scholars, because that sept is the prefix for the number 7. I don't know if your prefix is the right term, but like a septuplet would be 7 little youngsters. So the Septuagint was the first time that the book of Samuel was divided into two specific books. In the Old Testament, there are three sets of two books. We have 1 and 2 Samuel, which 1 Samuel will cover the birth of Samuel. It's the first book of Samuel is a book of transitions. It's a book of change. So we're going to see a change for the nation of Israel from a loose confederation of tribes into a centralized government under a king. So we're going to start off with them in the politically and religiously, the beginning of the book, they are in the same situation as in the book of Judges. In fact, the time covered during the first portion of Samuel is toward the end of the book of Judges. So 1 Samuel will cover the birth of Samuel, and it will cover the selection and reign of the very first king of Israel. And who was that first king?
Saul.
King Saul. That so we will cover that. And then at approximately, I believe, the 15th or 16th chapter, we'll be introduced to the famous king of Israel, which has had a great effect, and he is probably the greatest king ever to be on this planet that ruled as a king, and certainly the greatest king of the nation of Israel, and that was King David. So the primary characters that we will deal with will be Samuel and David. Some in an introduction would include King David, but King David is a secondary character in the book of 1 Samuel. The book of 2 Samuel, before we get into 2 Samuel, 1 Samuel covers approximately 115 years from the beginning to the death of Saul. And it was written sometime after the events, most likely during the reign of Solomon, or possibly Solomon's son, Rehoboam. And there's a variety of theories as to why the book was written. And I believe that most likely two primary reasons. One is to show that the line of David is the rightful line to the kingdom of Israel. Because when a king is, when you have a king, the rulers progress from him. You don't have a king and then a king from another family and a king from a different family after that. That's one of the things with a monarchy. It's a family thing. And we start out with a king, King Saul, and after 40 years, it changes to a different family. And there would be those that would be against that, would say this isn't right. The kingdom is supposed to flow in the line of the family. So this would explain then, as we read it, we'll see why that change took place, and we'll see that God, in fact, ordained that change. And it wasn't David coming up with this because he wanted to be the leader. This was God's plan. And then the other change that takes place that the book of 1 Samuel will explain is the change of the high priest. Again, the high priest follows the family line. But the high priest line will change from the family of Eli to the family of Zadok. And the reasons for that we will find in the book of Samuel. So there wasn't necessarily a single author. We don't have the exact information like we do on the New Testament. The New Testament was written much later, and we have solid information for every book. We know exactly who wrote it, and we know within 3 or 4 years, generally, of when the book was written. We don't have that with a number of books in the Old Testament, Samuel being one of those. So we know that the material used for Samuel, a good portion of that was, in fact, written by Samuel, and we also know that a portion of it couldn't have been written by Samuel because it covers a time period after his death. And the Bible specifically speaks of three people writing some of these events, and those are Samuel and a prophet named Nathan and a prophet named Gad. And the thing that we do not know is who the editor is, who took these materials and brought them together and made a book out of them. So on our outline here, this is an outline that I took from Chuck Swindoll's ministry, and you can see that along the bottom there. It shows that the first section of the book is dedicated to Samuel, and then the second section dedicated to King Saul. And then it's broken up in a variety of chapter 1 dealing with Samuel's birth. Chapters 2 and 3 are dealing with Samuel's very early years. Chapters 4 through 7 are Samuel's ministry. And then we see change in chapters 8 through 12. And that change is the change from having a judge to having a king. And then in chapters 13 through 16, we have the early portion of King Saul's reign, where he makes some major mistakes and he rejects the word of the Lord, and God in turn rejects him. And in the latter portion of the book, we actually see Saul rebelling against God's will and doing some interesting things. So that is the first book of Samuel. The second book of Samuel covers about 40 years, and that covers the life and the reign of King David. And then 1 and 2 Kings, 1 Kings chapters 1 through 11 are the life and ministry of King Solomon, and then from there, the Bible and the nation of Israel had a major change. As we read, and they don't really explain what's happening, as you're reading through it, you'll see at times they mention a nation called Judah, and at other times they mention a nation called Israel. But if you don't understand that there was a civil war and the nation split, it's really confusing because they're both Jewish, and they're both trying to worship the Lord and do various different things, and it can really be puzzling if you don't know that. So after the reign of Solomon, the nation split, and there were 10 tribes that were conglomerated to the north, and they were governed initially by a king named Jeroboam, and then the southern tribes of Judah and Benjamin were reigned over by Solomon's son, Rehoboam. There's a pattern in which we see throughout the books of 1 and 2 Samuel, and that is that we have a leader, and then something happens in his life where he goes downhill. A new leader is selected. That new leader will initially have some great victory, which proves that he is God's man. And then later on, we'll see a problem in his life, and then his demise, and then selection of a new leader. And that basic process carries on over and over and over again. And we will see that starting with Samuel. That'll happen with King Saul. And it happens actually to all of the kings. All of the kings go through that process. All right, so one question we may be asking ourselves is, why bother to study the Old Testament at all? Right? We know that Jesus came and his sacrifice for sin changed the requirement that God had, that we're not doing blood sacrifices any longer. So why do we cover this time period where this is what was taking place? And for that portion of the introduction, I'd like to invite up Michael as he comes and talks to us about why we study the Old Testament, and hear some thoughts on the book of Samuel from Mike as well. Mike, would you come on up? Yeah.
How you guys doing?
Good.
I'm honored that Bob asked me to join him in teaching this, and it's kind of, you know, my passion. It's what floats my boat. I love to teach. I think it's the best way to learn. Teachers are just the students with the most homework. I used to do it on Wednesday night, but it just kind of petered out. And I figured it's because I was competing with the groups. So when Bobby asked me to come on Tuesday nights, it's like I jumped at it. But now that I'm standing up here and can see some of my students, you bunch of traitors.
You quit on us on Wednesday.
I quit. But I kept coming back, and you didn't. All right, so, you know, a lot of people, a lot of Christians, and sadly, some of the ministers, the pastor, teachers themselves, don't see the need to be in the Old Testament. And to come from a pastor, teacher, that, to me, that was always bizarre. That hit me as strange. Because we're told to study, to show ourselves approved. And in the book of Romans, chapter 15, verse 4, it tells us why. For whatever things were written before were written for our learning, that we, through the patience and comfort of the scriptures, might have hope. It's for our example. It's for us to learn from. And then in 1 Corinthians 10:11, pretty much the same thing. So, you know, I was raised Jewish. There's three ways to become Jewish. If you're not, you're either born into it, you marry into it, or you're adopted into it. Well, when a person that's not Jewish accepts Jesus, guess what? They're born into it, they're adopted into it, and they're married into it. So Israel's history now becomes your history. That's the other reason this is important. This is your history. You're spiritual Jews. You were grafted onto the tree. So to neglect that is to neglect a huge portion of your biblical education. So that's the reason we study the Old Testament. So, First and Second Samuel, like Bobby said, it was always one book until the, you know, the Septuagint, and then they split it into two. But it's a powerful book. There's some pretty weird stuff in there too. Yeah. And it's like, how can you be sure Samuel didn't write that book? Because he dies in book one. So that's a problem. Unless he's a ghostwriter. And you know what? That's something that happens in here too. There's ghosts, there's witches, it's amazing. So I'm really looking forward to this. And once again, I thank you, Pastor Bobby, for having me do this with you. I'm honored. And I look forward to studying with you guys and getting to know every one of you. So thank you.
Shalom, Mike.
And so, shalom.
When Jesus read the Bible, what Bible did he read? We know Paul read the King James, right? A little humor there.
Yeah. Please be careful. There you go again.
This chair has it out for me.
Dangerous.
I fell earlier on my shoulder. Fortunately, not everybody was here to laugh at me. All right.
Yeah, the Bible that Jesus knew is the Old Testament. When the writers of the New Testament write their thoughts, their understanding of God is all shaped by the Old Testament. There's a practice that took place when the writers would write the covenant name of God. Whenever we are reading in the Old Testament and we see the word the Lord, if we go to 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 3, it says, "Now this man used to go up year by year from the city to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord of hosts. You see how the font changes there from just the normal to regular L and then a slightly smaller ORD, but in all caps. Everybody see that? Mm-hmm. Whenever we see that in the Old Testament, that is where the writers of the Old Testament have taken the covenant name of God, those three consonants, YHWH. And in an effort not to defile the name of God, not to have an issue with that, because they took his name very seriously, in an effort not to have an issue with that, they would not write the name of God. And to this day, many Jews won't even write the word God. You'll see a G and a dash or an underscore and a D. And that's just referring, it's not even the covenant name itself. But these writers, rather than writing that covenant name of God, which I'll pronounce Yahweh, they would write the Lord. And so every time that name comes up in the Old Testament, we rarely see it as Yahweh. We typically see it as the Lord. Now, the gentleman that wrote the New Testament, they understood this clearly. And when they wrote, they used a similar concept. And they wrote Jesus Christ, the Lord. And many will say that the Bible doesn't say that Jesus is God. Okay, it doesn't refer to him as God. There is no scripture that says these words, Jesus Christ is God. That part is quite true. But there are concept after concept and scripture after scripture that show he is. And right from the beginning, the New Testament writers referred to Jesus as Jesus Christ, the Lord, or the Lord Jesus Christ. They're picking up on what these Old Testament writers did, and they have the same thing going on there. So without an understanding of what's happening in the Old Testament, would we know that? We wouldn't have a clue. So it's going to be important for us to learn these things and to make them like second nature to us, so that when we're in the New Testament and we're reading the writings of Paul or the writings of Peter, we're able to pick up on this stuff like that. And so without further introduction, let's dig in. Can I get a volunteer to read verses 1 through 8? Manny.
This is from the ESV.
Thank you.
There was a certain man of Ramathaim Zophim of the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah, the son of Jeroham, son of Elihu, son of Tohu, son of Ziph, an Ephrathite. He had two wives. The name of the one was Hannah, and the name of the other Peninnah. Mm-hmm. And Peninnah had children, but Hannah had no children. I love this story. Mm-hmm. Now this man used to go up year by year from his city to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord our host at Shiloh, where the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were priests of the Lord. How far did you want me to go?
Verse 8.
Okay. On the day when Elkanah sacrificed, he would give portions to Peninnah, his wife, and all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he gave double the portion because he loved her. Though the Lord had closed her womb, and her rival used to provoke her grievously to irritate her because the Lord had closed her womb. So it went on year by year. As often as she went up to the house of the Lord, she used to provoke her. Therefore Hannah wept and would not eat. And Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep and why do you not eat? And why is your heart so sad? Am I not more to you than 10 sons?
Thanks, Manny. So, right from the start, we are introduced to the father of the man Samuel, who we're going to be reading about his conception and his birth shortly. And in that, we read that his father is an Ephrathite. And then as we progress on, we are going to learn that Samuel is a priest. And if we know our Old Testament at all, we know that the priests come from one family group. What family group do the priests come from?
Levi.
Exactly. So they're Levites. So how is Samuel a Levite and an Ephrathite? Is this a contradiction in the Bible already? Or is there an easy explanation? I believe there's an easy explanation. Ephrathah is an area. So it would be this, like, if we were referring to me, saying that I was a Lucas of California. I'm a Lucas, but I'm a Californian. Well, which am I? Am I a Lucas or am I a Californian? Well, I'm both, right? I'm from California, but I'm of the family of the Lucases. And that's the same with Samuel. He is, their family line will go back to the son of Jacob named Levi, but the area from which he lives is Ephrathah, and so he's called an Ephrathite. Another thing that we see right away in that first verse is we see a fairly long genealogy of him. Generally speaking, in the Old Testament, when we're introduced to somebody, we hear the person's name and then their father's name. Like when we hear of David, King David, he's referred to as David, the son of Jesse. And that's where it ends. With Elkanah, we're given a number of his line, and the reason that generally took place was because these were substantial people. These were men of renown, or they were men that they were a family that had wealth. Excuse me. And so with those families, they would give somewhat of a family line. And so we see that he is from the hill country of Ephraim. And his name is Elkanah, and I don't remember what his name meant. Mike, did you mention that as we were speaking earlier, what Elkanah meant?
No.
It slips my mind that moment. Generally, the meaning of names are important, and Elkanah is one of them that I didn't know. So we have Elkanah, the son of Jeroham, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zuth, and Ephrathite. Now, Elkanah has two wives. The name of one was Hannah, and the name of the other was Peninnah. And then it says Peninnah had children, but Hannah had none. Excuse me, had no children. And by the way, I read and I will teach from the ESV, the English Standard Version. So if you want to be able to follow along word for word, you'll need to be in the ESV. Manny, did you have something?
Yes, Elkanah is Hebrew baby name, and it means God has created.
Ah, very good. Thank you. So, this man has two wives. So, immediately we're dealing with the issue of polygamy. First off, I want to say that there is no scripture that says it is against God's law to have two wives. Never does God condemn having two wives. Never does God support having two wives. He's relatively silent on it throughout Scripture. But what we do see is right away in the book of Genesis, God says, it's not good for a man to be alone. So he should have five or six wives. No. He said he should have a wife. And the two should become one flesh. Not the three, or the five, or the 12, or the 700. Right? As we will read, if we get that far. King Solomon had 700 wives and 300 what they call concubines. A concubine is a slave They're kind of in a different class. They're a slave that he has chosen as his wife. So while they are now the wife of the king, they're still a slave. I'm sure they're probably better off than most people that weren't slaves, but they don't have the same status as one of the other wives. So Solomon was an interesting character. Elkanah, though, had two. During these times, it was critically important to have children. The nation of Israel, when they came into the land of Canaan and the land was divided up, it's allotted by family. And your land is your land. Today, there seems to be question in some people's mind of whose land is that over there that's called Israel? It tells us right here, it belongs to the nation of Israel. This belongs to the Jews. Doesn't belong to America, doesn't belong to Russia, doesn't belong to the Palestinians. That's whose it is. And when God gives something and he says it's forever, guess what? That's their land. Well, these would pass the land on from father to his son or sons, and they would pass their land on to their sons, and on and on and on. God set up special ways that if a man was in a bad way and he had to sell his property, that he had the right of redemption. We looked at those laws when we studied the book of Ruth before we took our break. So, very important to have children. Most of the commentaries that I read believe that the reason that Elkanah had two wives was because Hannah was barren. And I did overlook something. We noticed there at the latter portion of verse 2, it says, the name of one was Hannah, and the name of the other was Peninnah. Name order is important in the scripture. Okay? So Hannah was the number one wife. There's always always is a pretty big word. There's generally structure to the naming and the top person, like let's say we were listing out the congregation here at his place, whose name would be at the top?
Pastor Joe.
Because Pastor Joe is the one who runs the church here, right? Not administratively, but spiritually. So he would be at the top. So we see Hannah as the number one wife, and most of the commentators believe that the reason that he has this wife, Peninnah, is because she couldn't have children, and he needs children. The other reason that was very important to have children, besides having someone to hand the property down to, was that this is an agrarian society. We have fields, we have olive trees, we have vineyards, we have wheat, we have barley, we have all this stuff that we have to grow. These guys don't have combines, right? They don't have the machinery that we have, so one person cannot maintain 30 acres. They need workers. How do you get workers when everybody has their own fields? They don't want to go work in somebody else's field. How do you get workers? You get workers by having children. And the more children you have, the more workers you have. Like I was when I was a child. We were slaves to our parents. Whatever they said to do, we did it. Whether we liked it, didn't like it, whether it was hot, whether it was cold, we did what we needed to do and we were told to do. And that's the case here. So Hannah was barren. It says, Peninnah had children, but Hannah had none. Now in verse 3, we begin to see the character of this family of Elkanah. It says, now this man used to go up year by year from his city to worship and sacrifice to the Lord of hosts at Shiloh, where the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were priests of the Lord. So unlike we have today, we don't have centers of worship in every town during this time. And when there is a center of worship in every town, they're being disobedient to the Lord. He says, no, that's not my plan. That is not what I want. So when we read later on, as if we go further in past the books of Samuel, and we begin to read about there's high places, places of worship in every town and on every hill, we know that, they're being disobedient to God. So in order for them to, quote, go to church, they would have to pack up their family and make a trip. So they didn't go to church every week. It wasn't church. It was the place of worship. And we see that Elkanah was committed to a yearly pilgrimage, so to speak, from his place to Shiloh. And if we look at our map, I did not find Ephrathah on the map, but it should be somewhere in the area of Bethlehem. So, I kind of did this map last minute, so I'm going to find a better one, or I will continue to work on this one. You can see that I wrote over some of these towns so we could actually read this. So the very bottom one that I annotated there is Bethlehem, and most likely Ephrathah, the town that he was from, would be somewhere in that area. And they would travel to Shiloh, which is the northernmost one. It's just under the middle of the map there. And so they would make that journey, and they would do it once a year to worship and sacrifice to the Lord of Hosts at Shiloh. That's an interesting term, the Lord of Hosts. It could mean a variety of things. Most likely when you're speaking of hosts, you're speaking of he is the God of the angels. Or the hosts, some translations will say the God of battles or the God of war. So he goes to sacrifice. And then there's a brief mention here of the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, that they were priests of the Lord. Or we could actually say that they were acting as priests of the Lord. And as we get further in, you'll see why I say that. Now, interestingly, these two gentlemen, their names are Egyptian names. They don't have Jewish names. And so, verse 4, it says, on the day when Elkanah sacrificed, he would give portions to Peninnah, his wife, and to all her sons and daughters, but to Hannah he gave a double portion, because he loved her, though the Lord had closed her womb. It was shameful for a woman not to be able to have children. In this time period, that was one of the primary roles a woman had. Men are the provider, the protector of their home, and the woman was there to build the home. And part of building the home is building it with children. And Hannah didn't have any. It says here that the Lord had closed her womb. And because her womb was closed, she lived, she had a social stigma against her. And God is going to do something great through that as we read on. But that difficulty and further the relationship she has with the other wife, it causes great emotional strain for Hannah. And verse 6 says, and her rival used to provoke her grievously, to irritate her, because the Lord had closed her womb. So you can imagine all the things that she would say to her about the dusty womb and, you know, whatever other kind of comments she would make at her. And it would break her heart. Interestingly, that as we read of these polygamous marriages, we never read in the scripture of one that there's harmony.
No way.
They're all having difficulty. So her rival, and who would her rival be?
The other wife.
It would be the other wife, Peninnah. Yeah, not a rival from another country, right? No, a rival within their own home. And I, unfortunately, I can relate to this. When I was about in the second grade, my father remarried and brought in I had two stepsisters and a stepbrother. My stepbrother Johnny, he was 10 months older than me. And at that age, that 10 months was just enough physical difference where he could just pound me into the ground whenever he wanted to. And for years, he tormented me. My life was miserable because of that kid. And, you know, it was such a shame because we could have been best friends. You know, living under the same roof, oftentimes we were in the same classroom at school, we had the same homework to do, but for whatever purpose, he didn't want that. And so he tormented me continually, and there were times that I absolutely hated life because of that. I couldn't, you know, and I couldn't get away from it, right? It's in my own home, and it changed with testosterone, thank God. When I turned 13, then my body began to develop, and I was a match for him, and once I was able to meet him toe-to-toe, so to speak, the whole thing changed, and we became very good friends, and we loved each other at that point, and you know, our relationship, and I have good memories of that part, but the early portion, it was horrible. And I can see that here for poor Hannah. So it says, as often as she went up to the house of the Lord, she used to provoke her. Therefore Hannah wept and would not eat. So just a little side comment. You always go up to the house of the Lord. You always go up to Jerusalem. And it's not necessarily because it's on a hill, although Jerusalem is on a hill. It's, the thought is, and whether you are going, generally when we say going up or going down, we go down to San Diego, but we go up to Santa Barbara, right? Well, if Santa Barbara, or excuse me, if San Diego was Jerusalem, we would say we're going to go up to San Diego because you're going up spiritually. Mm-hmm. When you go to the house of the Lord, you are going up. So, as often as they went up to the house of the Lord, she used to provoke her. Therefore, Hannah wept and would not eat. If you've ever struggled with depression and extreme anxiety, you can't eat. She has no appetite. And these feasts of the Lord, just that. They were festivals. These were feasts. These were huge barbecues, right? These are a time to party. We're living it up. This is not, I'm dreading going to church because they're going to sing that song again over and over and over until you're pulling your hair out. No, these are things that they would look forward to every year, and they bring their best animal, and they sacrifice that animal, and a portion goes to the Lord. A portion goes to the priest, and a portion comes back to the family to eat, right? And this is a wonderful time that God had designed for the people to enjoy being in the presence of God. But Hannah cannot enjoy that because of her struggle. And so she wept, and she would not eat. In verse 8, it says, and Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep? And why do you not eat? And why is your heart so sad? Didn't say so. Am I not more to you than 10 sons? So the 10 sons there is just a colloquialism. It's not necessarily a definite number. And really, you know, he's trying to console his wife, but he's really not doing a good job here. You know, hey, yeah, I love you, but you know what? I want kids. And all the words coming out of your mouth aren't changing anything but making it worse, right? Manny, would you read verses 9 through to 20 for us?
After they had eaten and drunk in Shiloh, Hannah rose. Now Eli the priest was sitting on the seat beside the doorpost of the temple of the Lord. She was deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. And she bowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of our servant and remember me and not forget your servant, you will give to your servant a son. Then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall touch his head. As she continued praying before the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was speaking in her heart, only her lips moved, and her voice was not heard. Therefore, Eli took her to be a drunken woman. And Eli said to her, how long will you go on being drunk? Put away your wine from you. But Hannah answered, no, my Lord, I am a woman troubled in spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but I have been pouring out my soul before the Lord. Do not regard your servant as a worthless woman. For all along I have been speaking out of my great anxiety and vexation. Then Eli answered, go in peace, and the God of Israel grant your petition that you have made to him. And she said, let your servant find favor in your eyes. And the woman went to her way and ate, and her face was no longer sad. They rose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord. Then they went back to their house at Ramah. And Elkanah knew Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her. And in due time, Hannah was conceived and bore a son. And she called his name Samuel, for she said, I have asked for him from the Lord.
Thanks, man. So after they had eaten and drunk in Shiloh, Hannah rose. You know, I did overlook something, that the tabernacle where they worship the Lord and they do these sacrifices, it's now located stationary in Shiloh. This is the tent of meeting that traveled with the Israelites while they were in the wilderness. It moved around as they moved around. And when Joshua got to the end of the battles, he set it there in Shiloh, and it has remained there for roughly about 300 years now. And remember, it's a tent, right? It's a tent. It's not a building. And a 300-year-old tent is an old tent. So there's thought that, because there's going to be some places here, like in verse 9 it says, now Eli the priest was sitting on the seat beside the doorpost of the temple. Well, doorpost and temple don't say tent, right, and portable. The thought is that there was a structure, a more substantial structure, built around the tent to protect it at this point, because it was getting rather old. So after they had eaten and drunk there in Shiloh, Hannah rose. Now Eli the priest was sitting beside the doorpost of the temple of the Lord. She was deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. You know, when we are deeply distressed as Christians, there's generally two ways that we go. And unfortunately, some will go away from the Lord. They will leave the faith. They may say, I still believe in God, but they don't fellowship and they don't go to church and they don't pursue the Lord anymore. And then on the other hand, others, when they are deeply distressed, will press in, and that time of distress will prove to be a point that they are closer to the Lord than at any other time in their life. So I would caution you that if you are in that time, a difficult time, to press in. Don't be inclined to walk away. We have personal examples of people that we know who walk away during difficult times. And we've also have personal examples of those that in very difficult times press in. It says, you know, our life is a series of the results of decision after decision. And that is a critical decision. So deeply distressed, she prays to the Lord. So she starts off here with being open and honest to the Lord. So in verse 11 it says, she vowed a vow to the Lord. She said, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your servant and remember me no more, and remember me, and not forget your servant, but will give to your servant a son, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall touch his head. When we're desperate, we often vow to the Lord. If you do this, I'm doing this. And I'll tell you, as a young man, there were a number of times I made vows to the Lord, and as soon as that, whatever I was praying for came through, I forgot all about my vow. You know, I think it's very important, as Hannah does here. Generally, I would say we want to avoid vows. Jesus kind of says, you know, don't be doing that. But if you do make a vow to the Lord, that's one you want to keep. So she says, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your servant. So what is that affliction that she has? It's that barrenness. That's how she's afflicted. And remember me, and not forget your servant. She feels that God has overlooked her. He's blessed all the other women with children, but somehow she didn't get picked. You know, it's like you're out there in the playground and they're choosing teams, and I'm still standing here, right? And they're off playing. She says, if you do that, if you will give me not just a child, she's very specific here, and I like that. She says, if you give me a son, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall touch his head. So Hannah has vowed here to do literally what we must do figuratively with our children, and that is give them to the Lord. This, I believe, is where the concept of dedicating our children to the Lord comes from. As Christians, we don't baptize babies. We believe that baptism is for those who can make a conscious decision to follow Christ, unlike the Catholic Church. But we do dedicate children to the Lord, and I believe that this is a scriptural, a place in Scripture that we find that we can base that practice on. So she says, I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razors shall touch his head. So this is what is known as the Nazirite vow. No razor shall touch his head. And also, there's a second portion of that goes along with that. Does anybody remember what that is? What is it?
Yeah, no grapes or no wine.
Right, no wine. And most likely the reason that no wine isn't mentioned here is because that's not going to take place for quite a while, right? With a child, you really don't have to worry about him drinking wine for some period of time. So as she continued praying before the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was speaking in her heart, only her lips moved and her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli took her to be a drunken woman. And Eli said to her, how long will you go on being drunk? Put away your wine from you. So apparently, silent prayer wasn't common during this time. When people would go to pray, somebody would expect to hear something, right? Silent prayer is very common in our day, but apparently it wasn't then. But what was common was drunkenness in the temple. And as we get further and we see some of the actions of Eli's sons, we're going to see that. It was definitely a wicked time. So he doesn't know what's going on when he sees her lips moving and no words coming out, and he accuses her of being drunk. And I love Hannah's reply here, because she is a woman that she is tore up emotionally, and she could have struck out at him and just lashed out at him. What do you mean I'm drunk? But she doesn't. She's a very humble woman. Look at her response here. No, my Lord, I am a woman troubled in spirit. I am, and she answers to his accusation. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink. But here's what I've been doing. I've been pouring out my soul to the Lord. Do not regard your servant as a worthless woman. For all along, I have been speaking out of my great anxiety and vexation. So she, rather than lashing out, which I think would be a natural response to that, instead, she explains in a very humble way. And look at Eli's response then in verse 17. Then Eli answered, "Go in peace, and the God of Israel grant your petition that you have made of him." And she said, "Let your servant find favor in your eyes." Then the woman went her way and ate, and her face was no longer sad. This is a woman of faith. This is a woman that when times are difficult, and she's obviously had years and years of this, right? It says year after year they would go up, and this is what took place. She's had years of this, and she hears one word from that priest. She hears him say one thing: go in peace, and the God of Israel grant your petition that you have made. And she takes that as a sign that God is going to answer her prayer, and she, just like that, just like being asleep and waking up, she just turns. She's no longer in her depression, and she's able to go back and eat. This is a point of release for her faith. Just like we see when the woman that was pressing in the crowd and touched the hem of Jesus' garment. Remember that story? They're in this crowd and there's people all around. And there's this woman, then she gets through the crowd and she touches the hem of Jesus' garment. And she is healed like that. Well, what power does a garment have? Is it because it was on his skin? I don't think so. That's a point of release for her faith. Because she had said in her mind, when I touch that, I'm going to be healed. And God honored that. And he healed her. And God honors Hannah here, believing the word of the Lord. This priest said, go in peace and may God grant your petition to him. And she took that in faith and flipped around, and everything was different from her from that day on. So she ate and her face was no longer sad. Verse 19. They rose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord. Then they went back to their house at Ramah. And it says, Elkanah knew Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her. I want to focus just a minute on that term, knew. Some of your Bibles may say that he slept with her, but it's much more than that. When the Bible says that he knew her, there are two types of knowledge that we have. We have intellectual knowledge, that we read a book and we understand something. And we have experiential knowledge, right? Like, I know how to ride a motorcycle because I have the experience of doing it. Elkanah knew his wife. He experienced her, right? That's what it says, that Adam knew Eve and they had children. And I want to, we've got just a couple of minutes. I want to take a field trip and go over to Psalm 91, which we heard, was that last weekend or the weekend before? The weekend before last. And I want to just kind of piggyback on that message that was preached by the visiting pastor. Well, he's a member of our church, but visiting to the pulpit. Take a look at verse 14. The English Standard Version says, well, first off, it goes through all these promises and says, you're going to be able to do this, you're going to be able to do that, You know, you're not going to have these difficulties. You're going to have great victories. There's no reason to live in fear. And verse 14 says why. Why you can have this confidence that this is the story of your life. Because he holds fast to me in love, I will deliver him. I will protect him because he knows my name. That's the same word translated there, knows, as Hannah, Elkanah knew Hannah, or the one, if we were to go back to Genesis 3, that, or 4, that Adam knew Eve. So that's the basis of our Christian faith. It's not that we have an intellectual knowledge of God. It's that we experience him. That's one of the main differences between Christianity and other faiths. Is ours, it's based on truth. It's not based on experience, but there is a heavy experience within that truth. We experience God. We know God. We know him both ways. We know him intellectually because we read the scriptures and we learn about him, but we know him experientially because we live with him. We walk with him day by day. We bring prayer requests to him and we see him move on our behalf. We look at other people. We see people in the hospital being healed. We hear testimonies. As we're going to hear going forward in our class here, we're going to hear testimonies of how God moved in people's lives. And we experience God. So, just a little piggyback off that, that message. I will protect him because he knows my name. Back to 1 Samuel, verse 20, and in due time, they got to enjoy knowing each other. It wasn't immediate. In due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son, and she called his name Samuel, for she said, I have asked for him from the Lord. I have a son named Samuel. Because I tricked my wife. I would take her birth control pills, pop them into the toilet, put the case back up on them. And I was praying to the Lord, but I was taking action as well. And I have a son, and I named him Samuel because I asked the Lord for him. That name Samuel, basically it means heard of God. And that's where we will we'll finish off tonight. Not sure how we're going to approach next week because those verses 21 through 27 will probably, or 28 there, will probably take about 15 minutes and then turn it over to you. Mike and I haven't co-taught with each other before, so we're learning this out. One of the things that is, I think, is critical is that we finish on time. And for, you know, I could take another 15 minutes and finish this up. One, I don't want to rush through it. And two, we've got children in there. Some of us do. I think it's going to be very important that every night we finish, every night we're here, we finish by 8:30, and we will. Okay? Mike, would you lead us out in prayer, please?
Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your presence. We ask that you would just keep doing work in us that we're not able to do in ourselves. And Lord, that we would grow in you.